Recorded Books presents This Other Eden by Paul Harding, narrated by Edoardo Ballerini. From the Maine Coast Heritage Trust, Malaga Island was home to a mixed-race fishing community from the mid-1800s to 1912, when the state of Maine evicted 47 residents from their homes and exhumed and relocated their buried dead. 8 islanders were committed to the Maine School for the Feeble-Minded. I think the best plan would be to burn down the shacks with all of their filth, then-Governor Frederick Plaisted told a reporter at the time. In 2010, the Maine legislature passed a resolution expressing its profound regret. 1. Benjamin Honey, American, Bantu, Igbo, born enslaved, freed or fled at 15, only he ever knew, ship's carpenter, aspiring orchardist, arrived on the island with his wife Patience, née Rafferty, Galway girl, in 1793. He brought his bag of tools, gifts from a grateful captain he had saved from drowning, or plunder from a ship on which he had mutinied and murdered the captain, depending on who said, and a watertight wooden box containing 12 jute pouches. Each pouch held seeds for a different variety of apple. Honey collected the seeds during his years as a field worker and later as a sailor. He remembered being in an orchard as a child, although not where or when, with his mother, or with a woman whose face over the years had become what he pictured as his mother's, and he remembered the fragrance of the trees and their fruit. The memory became a vision of the garden to which he meant to return. No mystery, it was Eden. Years passed, and he added seeds to his collection. He recited the names at night before he slept. Ashmead's Kernel, Flower of Kent, Duchess of Oldenburg, and Warner's King. Ballyfatten, Cat's Head. After Benjamin and Patience Honey arrived on the island, hardly 300 feet across a channel from the mainland, just under 42 acres, 1,200 feet across east to west, and 1,500 feet long north to south, uninhabited then, the only human trace an abandoned Penobscot shell berm, and after they had settled themselves, he planted his apple seeds. Not a seed grew. Benjamin was so infuriated by his ignorance that over the next year he crossed to the mainland whenever he could spare some time, and sought out orchards and their owners in the countryside beyond the village of 6 or 7 houses called Foxden that stood directly across the channel from the island, and traded his carpentry skills for seeds and advice about how they grew and how to cultivate the trees and their fruit. Benjamin and Patience and their sons and daughters and grandsons and granddaughters and great-grandchildren kept more and more to the island as time passed. But in the final years of the 18th century, it was not as dangerous as it came to be later for black men to range the land. Any able-bodied adult who kept peace and lent a hand surviving was accepted. So the story went among his descendants. So Benjamin rambled around and found farms where he could help raise a barn, or split shingles, or clear an acre for crops, and came home with seeds that quickened and struck roots and elaborated themselves into the shapes of his remembered paradise. Roxbury russets, Rhode Island greenings, woodpeckers, and Newtown pippins. Benjamin Honey kept an orchard of 32 apple trees that began to bear fruit in the late summer of 1814, a decade after he planted them. Pippins were perfect for pies, woodpeckers for cider. Children bit sour greenings on dares and laughed at one another when their eyes watered and mouths puckered. Russets were best straight from the tree. Benjamin Honey surveyed his orchard in the cooling air and sharpening, iridescent, ocean-bent sunset light, the greens and purples deepening from the radiant flat daybright into catacombs of shadowed fruit and limb and leaf. It felt as if his mother were somewhere among the rows. She might step from behind a tree in a white Sunday dress that took up the shifting light and colors and smile at him. He inhaled the perfume, salted as everything on the island, and took a bite of the apple he held. On the first day of spring, 1911, Esther Honey, great-granddaughter of Benjamin and Patience, dozed in a rocking chair by the wood stove in her cabin on Apple Island. Snow poured from the sky. Wind scoured the island and smacked the windows like giant hands, and kicked the door like a giant heel, and banked the snow up the north side of the shack until it reached the roof. the island a granite pebble in the frigid Atlantic shallows, the clouds so low their bellies scraped on the tip of Penobscot pine at the top of the bluff. Esther drowsed with her granddaughter, Charlotte, in her lap, curled up against her spare body, wrapped in a pane of Hudson's Bay wool from a blanket long ago cut into quarters and shared among her freezing ancestors, and a century-old quilt stitched from tatters even older. The girl took little warmth from her raw-boned grandmother, and the old woman practically had no need for the heat her grandchild gave, no place, practically, to fit it, being so slight and so long accustomed to the minimum warmth necessary for a body to keep living, but each was still comforted by the other. Esther's son Eha, Charlotte's father, rose from his stool and one at a time tossed four of the last dozen wooden shingles onto the embers in the stove. The Relief Society inexplicably had sent a pallet of the shingles to the settlement last summer. There was no need for them. Eha and Zachary, hand-to-God proverbs, were excellent carpenters and could make far finer cedar shingles than these. But as with each of the past 4 years, summer brought food and goods from the Relief Society, and some of the supplies were puzzling to the Apple Islanders, like the shingles, or a horse saddle once, for an island that only had a handful of humans and three dogs on it. With the food and stock also came Matthew Diamond, a single retired schoolteacher who, under the sponsorship of the Enon College of Theology and Mission, traveled from somewhere in Massachusetts each June to stay in his summer home, visible on the mainland in clear weather 300 yards across the channel in the village of Foxton, and row his boat to Apple Island each morning, where he preached, helped with a kitchen garden here, a leaky roof there, and taught lessons in the one-room schoolhouse he and Eha Honey and Zachary Hand-to-God Proverbs had built. "Useless spalt anyway," Eha said, closing the wood stove on the last of the shingles. Tabitha Honey, Eha's older daughter, 10 years old, 2 years older than her sister Charlotte, scooted on her behind across the cold floor to get closer to the stove. She wore 2 pairs of stockings, 3 old dresses, a donated wool coat the society had sent, and the 1 pair of shoes she owned, boys' boots passed down from her big brother Ethan when he'd outgrown them. They were too big for her, and she'd stuffed the toes and heels with dry grass that poked out of the split soles like whiskers. Tabitha wore another square of the Hudson's Bay blanket wrapped over her head and shoulders. "Come here, Victor," Tabitha said to the cat curled behind the stove. "Tick-tick, come here, Vic." She wanted the cap for her lap for some warmth. Victor raised his head and looked at the girl. He lowered his head back down and half-closed his eyes. "I hope you catch fire, you no-good hunks," Tabitha said. Ethan, Honey, 15, Eha's oldest child, sat on a wooden crate across the room, in the coldest corner, drawing his grandmother and little sister with a lump of charcoal on an old copy of the local newspaper that Matthew Diamond had given him last fall, the day before he closed up his summer house and returned to Massachusetts. The boy's nose was red, his lips purple. His fingers and hands were mottled white and blue, as if the blood were wicking into clots of frost under their skin. He concentrated on his grandmother and sister, and their entwined figures came into finer and finer view across the front page of the Foxton Journal, seeming to hover above the articles about the 10th annual drill and ball, 6 Chinamen deported, a missing 3-masted schooner, ads for fig syrups, foundries, soft hats, and black dress goods. "Tell us about the flood, Granny," Tabitha said, still eyeing the cat. Charlotte lifted her head from her grandmother's breast and said, "Yes, tell us again, Graham." Ethan looked from his drawing to his grandmother and sister and back. He said nothing, but wanted as much as his sisters for his grandmother to tell the story about the hurricane that had nearly sunk the island and had nearly swept away his whole family. Eha went from the stove to the corner opposite where Ethan drew and tipped a basket sitting on a shelf toward him and looked into it. "I'll fix these potatoes and there's a little salt fish left," he said. "A can of milk, too." "Do you want to hear about the flood? That old flood? Again?" Esther Honey said.
"Yes, Graham, please. Please, Graham, tell us."
"Well, that old flood was almost 100 years ago now," she began. "Way back in 1815.
A hurricane struck in September of 1815, 22 years after Benjamin and Patience Honey had come to the island and begun the settlement, by which time there were nearly 30 people living there, in 5 or 6 houses,
including the first proverbs and lark folks, the ones from Angola and Cape Verde, the others from Edinburgh. Patience herself from Galway, Ireland, originally, before she met Benjamin on his way through Nova Scotia and went with him. And three Penobscot women, sisters who'd lost their parents when they were little girls. A surge of seawater 20 feet high funneled up the bay, sweeping houses and ships along with it. When the wall of ocean hit, it tore half the trees and all the houses off the island, guzzling everything down, along with 2 honeys, 3 proverbs, 1 of the Penobscot sisters, 3 dogs, 6 cats, and a goat named Enoch. The hurricane roared so loudly, Patience Honey thought she'd gone deaf at first. That is, until she heard the tidal mountain avalanching toward them, bristling with houses and ships and trees and people and cows and horses churning inside it, screaming and bursting and lowing and neighing and shattering and heading right for the island. Then she knew all might well be lost, that this might well be the judgment of exultation, the sealed message unsealing, that after they'd all been swept away by the broom of extermination, there'd be so few trees left standing, a young child would be able to count them up, and their folks would be scarcer than gold. But not all gone, not everyone, Patience knew. Some honeys would persist, some proverbs survive, a lark or two might endure. So for reasons she could never afterward explain, she snatched the homemade flag she'd snitched together from patches of the stars and stripes and the Portuguese crown and golden Irish harp shaped like a woman, who looked so much like a figurehead and always reminded her husband of the one on the front of the ship he'd been a sailor on, that had sunk off the coast and brought him to the island in the first place, and the faded, faint squares embroidered with Bantu triangles and diamonds and circles that he'd carried with him everywhere, that he showed her meant man and woman and marriage and the rising sun and the setting sun, that he always said were his great-grandfathers, although she in her heart of hearts didn't think that that could be true, and tied it like a scarf around her throat. And she took Benjamin by the hand and dragged him from their shack out into the whirlwind. She swore it was a premonition, because no sooner had she and her husband passed out the door than the house broke loose from its pilings and tumbled away behind them, bouncing and breaking apart into straw like a bale of hay bouncing off a rick and into the ocean. Now that she stood in the open, facing the bedlam, her legs would not work. She was sure that this was the judgment, and what was to be. It was useless to try to outrun the outstretched arm of the Lord. Benjamin roared to her over the roaring storm, "The tree! The tree!" And he pointed to the tallest tree on the island, the Penobscot pine, at the top of the bluff. Benjamin pointed and leaned his face toward his wife's and pointed. "Up the tree!" Wind plastered his shirt, and the rain lashed and streamed down his face and ran from his hair, and lightning broke across the sky, and thunder blasted against the earth and sea, and he roared again over the roaring storm, "The tree!" And Patience thought of their grown children and their young grandchildren, and cried to her husband, "The children!" And Benjamin looked beyond his wife, and there were their children and grandchildren, drenched and shouldering their way against the winds and lashing rains, the ocean rising now up to the window of the lark's old shack, and pouring into it through the broken panes, and the largest surging waves thundering nearly up to where his own house had stood not 2 minutes before, and sucking all the earth right off the very rocks and into the black and grey and brooding jade Atlantic. And he cried, "Go to the tree!" And he ran toward his grown children and young grandchildren and grabbed 2 soaking little ones from their mothers and carried 1 each under his arms and ran toward the tree. And the wind roared and spun, and they staggered against it, now nearly blown toward the bluff, now nearly blown back away from it. When they reached the tree, one of Benjamin and Patience's sons, I think she always said it was Thomas, stood on Benjamin's shoulders, and the other sons and daughters climbed up the 2 men and reached the lowest branches of the old tree. And once they got their footing as best they could in the middle of bedlam, the others tossed the waterlogged children up to them 1 by 1. Once Patience had climbed into the tree and Thomas followed her up from Benjamin's shoulders, Benjamin himself scaled the trunk like the mast of a ship and roared once more, "As high as he can climb!" And all the honeys in that old tree climbed with all their strength, the children screaming and crying, the men and women screaming and crying, until the whole soaked clan clung together and to the trunk in a trembling, grasping cluster at the top of that swaying, bending, mighty old tree snapping back and forth in the wind like a whip. And right then, they all heard a great thunder rumble from the clamor, and the whole island quaked under them, telegraphing their extinction. And at that moment, Patience Honey, holding one of her grandbabies tight as could be against her side with one arm, and clenching the tree with the other, looked to the south down the bay, and there she saw that piled ocean, all the trees and buildings and shrieking people and wagons and sloops and schooners churning in its saltwater guts, and an old sea captain named Burnham in his pilot coat rowing a dinghy on the blazing crest of it all, smoking a pipe, bowl downward to keep the water out, crying for mad joy at this last rapturous pile-up. And all of it, that great massif of water and ruin speeding right for the honeys in their tree, which now seemed like a twig, a toothpick, a drenched blade of grass set against the immensity of that mountain range of ocean and demolition. What was always so eerie about it afterward, Patience always said, what was so terrifying about it that made her bowels feel as if they'd turned to sand, was how quiet it all seemed. Like a breath drawn and held, right before it hit. How breathtakingly fast, but nearly silent. And so just plain beautiful it was. All those people and trees and ships and horses cartwheeling past within the billows. It wasn't silent, really, but more. So loud it was too big to hear. I could not hear it for that second, because it was just too big a sound for my ears to hear. The water hit the south shore of the island first, and swallowed it whole and smooth. Then it hit the jagged bedrock spine running up the middle of the island, and broke over it, hissing like a saw blade. When it struck the slope of the bluff, it exploded across the horizon in front of the islanders and the tree, hung up and suspended for a moment in an apocalyptic entablature that Patience afterward always said looked in that instant before it all collapsed back together and swept along, how the parted sea must have appeared to the poor Israelites. I was pretty well given up on it all, and in that tree holding it so hard the bark cut into my arms and gave me these scars, and holding that baby so hard against me I thought I'd crack it, drenched to the marrow and screaming and trying not to let go. But when that tower of ocean and ruination burst apart in front of me, in a blink, but deep is my soul, I saw a broad, dry avenue running through the middle of the sea, and it was thronged with shepherds and sheep and old ladies on donkeys, litters of children curled up asleep on hay in the beds of rickety carts. The parted ocean towered on both sides, sheer, smooth, and monolithic, and inside the water a pell-mell cavalcade of Egyptian men and horses and chariots scrolled past, tumbling heel over headdress, fetlock over cannon, bumper over shaft. Most of the men wore linen tunics, but some wore leopard skins and feathers and had elaborate headdresses. Some of them were tethered to their chariots by leather reins and held longbows. Arrows and spears twirled among the men and horses and cars. Their black-lined eyes stared wide open, but they were all clearly drowned. And I knew what it was like when God parted the sea. And I knew that Moses was way up there at the front of the line. Not like the idea of Moses, but the man himself, the very man, Moses, when God opened the ocean. Then the waters collected all the relic and rubble back up and swept over the rest of the island. The water churned and rose up the penobscot pine laden with the honeys. Patience looked down through the branches and limbs, and watched the seething waters rise over her children's and grandchildren's feet, billow up their skirts, and rise over their midriffs, and up their exposed throats, then into their sputtering mouths. And she watched their hair soak up the boiling waters. And she watched the waters swill Benjamin up, too. And she watched her daughter, Charity Honey, wrench free from the tree and tumble away in the wreckage, clutching her baby son David in her arms. And the waters reached her feet, and she felt something deep down in the bottom of the tree crack and give, and the tree bowed, and she was in the swift and roaring waters up to her waist. And the tree levered itself back upright, Though it seemed not to swallow at her quite as greedily as it first had, the water still rose, and it reached Patience's collarbone, and Patience always said she could just see the top of Benjamin's head below her in the water. Serene, almost. Almost becalmed. Tiny bubbles of air rising from his hair. And it was then, just as the water touched it at her throat, that Patience remembered the old flag she'd sewn for Benjamin from the bits and pieces of other flags, and national rags, and bedraggled patches, not long after they'd married and first settled their now drowning island, still tied around her neck. She always said later, "I just decided right then that if we were all going to judgment, I was going to fly our little flag until the last possible second. So I hoisted that baby up even more and pressed it between the tree and my breast harder than I ever otherwise would have dared, and freed my hand and somehow unknotted the flag from my neck and held it in my hand and held my hand up just as high as I could get it, and the wind took the flag up and snapped it and practically tore it from off my grasp, but I kept hold, and there it flew. Then the water rose over the baby, who'd gone past wailing, and just stared, wedged between my body and the tree, dumbfounded at the pandemonium, wide-eyed and quiet as it burbled under, and the water reached my mouth and covered my face and went over my head, and still I held that foolish flag as high as I could, and the water rose up my shoulder, and the water rose up to my raised elbow, and the water rose up my forearm, and the water reached my wrist, and so there was just my one hand holding that motley little tattered flag sticking up above the surface of the flood, and the waters rose up my fingers, and just as my hand was about to disappear, and that flag and all us honeys be swallowed up in the catastrophe, the water stopped rising. The surge struck the innermost of the bay, spilled onto the mainland, dumping the foremost of the ruin it had ploughed along the way onto a campsite called Little Shell Cove, where 100 years later campers still turned up trinkets from the calamity, and the cauldron of wrath doubled back on itself and withdrew, quaffing the people, creatures, pie-safes, pews, and catboats it had failed to devour the first time, caterwauling off toward the horizon. The water stopped rising and seemed to pause. It was as if my hand and the sputtering flag were at the center of a great whirlpool guzzling the island down its throat. But then the eddying slowed and stopped, then began to unwind. Patience Honey clung to the penobscot pine under the water, the baby in her arms limp, eyes closed then, asleep against her breast inside the bosom of the sea. Patience looked down the length of the tree into the garbled dark. Bodies clung to it below. Benjamin, her cousin and best friend, Shekinah Goodfellow. Deeper down, the island appeared to move. It began to revolve around the tree, like a dark stone wheel around a wooden axle. It was a whale, circling, nosing at Patience and the other fugitives newly arrived in his kingdom, until he caught sight of an ancient great white shark cruising through the schoolhouse, trolling for drowned children and spinster marms. The whale launched after its prehistoric nemesis, and the monsters jetted away from the shallows of the newly drowned world back into the proper abyss. I could no longer hold my breath. Just as I had to give out and inhale the Atlantic into my lungs and swallow it into my guts like a last meal of seawater soup, the whirlpool began to uncoil from around my hand, and the flag in the water began to lower. My arms seemed to rise out of the water. Then my head and body, along with the penobscot pine, too, which rose like the mast of a wrecked ship unsinking. The ship, I mean the island, and I surfaced and rose above the water, and the wind dashed against my face, and I gasped at the air and lost hold of the tree. Patience shucked herself from the mud and sand in which she lay face down at the base of the tree. The infant under her unrecognizable, not even clearly boy or girl, just a naked, wrung-out, beslimed little pup squashed into the humus. She poked a finger in its mouth to unplug the earth from its throat. Its nose was clogged, too, so she sealed her mouth over the baby's whole face and sucked as hard as she dared, and the muck uncorked and spattered into her mouth. She spat to the side and watched the child. The infant belched a ladleful of seawater, opened its eyes, which seemed as if they did not see, opened its mouth, and for a moment lay petrified and silent. It barked and gurgled and gathered its breath and shrieked. The baby shrieked and shrieked, and Patience thumbed gunk from its eyes and ears and looked at her husband. Benjamin was pressed into the mud and debris, face up, staring at the low clouds sizzling and flashing overhead. Patience knew what he was thinking. She saw his hope and heart draining into the ocean with their lost children and grandchildren, and with his apple trees, those trees that he had labored so long and so hard at because they reminded him of the one place he remembered being with his mother when he was a little boy. Grief overtook her, and as she began to panic and cry hysterically and scrambled up, looking for who else was left, the baby still howling too, she looked at her husband, who had come from nowhere and taken her away from nowhere to try to find somewhere together, who she had loved the moment she first saw him, and she knew she had to fetch him back from the brink of the pit. "It's still Apple Island," she screamed, sobbing the name of her wind and wailing child, and through her own wailing that now felt like it was erupting straight out of her heart, spouting from her in gouts as she searched in every direction for her children and their children. "It's Apple Island! It is Apple Island!" Benjamin Honey looked at his wife crying to him, fierce and true. But she was wrong. His orchard, so fair in appearance, was a folly. His half-remembered Eden, no sooner restored than carried off by little wind and rain. Esther finished the story of the flood. Halfway through the telling, she always found herself saying, "I held the baby. I couldn't hold my breath," which scared and thrilled everyone listening, nearly conjuring as it did their common first mother. And so there the last of the Honeys were, fourth, fifth, and sixth generations distillate of Angolan fathers and Scottish grandpas, Irish mothers and Congolese grannies, Cape Verdean uncles and Penobscot aunts, cousins from Dingle, Glasgow, and Montserrat, the wind thumping, the snow swirling, their stomachs growling, their toes and fingers burned black to icicles, crowding the cooling wood stove, the girls asleep. Ethan paused at his drawing, imagining that old local calamity. Eha, too, quieted, calmed, thoughtful, thrilled and hallowed by the story they all knew as well as the one from the Bible. Better, even. Noah had his ark, the Honeys had Apple Island. After another moment of quiet, Eha said, "Dinner." And Grammy Esther roused sleeping Charlotte from her lap, and Ethan woke Tabitha, sprawled on the floor, and the Honeys ate around the now cooling wood stove, and the wind and snow whistled and whirled outside. Esther recited a bit of scripture. "Yet the dogs eat of the crumbs from the master's table." Each child received a strip of salted cod, half a potato, and two roasted chestnuts, the last from the previous fall, to celebrate the coming spring. Eha removed the plug of tobacco tucked in his cheek, placed it gently on his knee, and ate his half potato in two bites. He closed his eyes, sighed two hymnal notes, and replaced the chew in his mouth. Grammy did not eat. She smoked her pipe and drank her tea, black as oil, smelly as tar, from a chipped china cup with no handle. The first sundown of spring came over Apple Island. Light had been lingering later each evening, but the storm made for early dark. Eha could check his trap for a lobster after the storm. The children could scoop clams at low tide, midnight, Lotta holding the lantern in the dark, singing ghost songs, Ethan and Tabby digging in the icy sand. Like his father and grandfather, Ethan at 15 already had the habits into which all the islanders grew, of smoking or chewing tobacco, or both, and drinking mulchy black tea to nip morning, noon, and supper-time pangs, if not real hunger. Hunger wore everyone to exhaustion. The family wrapped and huddled around the stove, heads bowed, meager dinner, almost making things worse. Two other families, the McDermotts and the Larks, lived on Apple Island besides the Honeys, as well as old Annie Parker, who lived alone, and Zachary Hand-to-God Proverbs, who lived by himself too, mostly inside a hollow tree, although he had a shack he'd built for himself years before. The three families lived within sight of one another on the north end of the island, in homes built on top of beds of crushed shells just above the beach. Annie Parker and Zachary Hand-to-God lived on the south end of the island, Annie on the west side, Zachary on the east. As night came and spring commenced beyond the borders of the spinning blizzard, all the souls on Apple Island hunkered in their homes and held out for fairer seasons. The Larks lived not a quarter mile from the other families on the north end of the island, but may as well have been camped on the moon. Theophilus and Candace Lark were called cousins, but the other adult Apple Islanders knew it was most likely that they were half-brother and sister, and very possibly downright brother and sister. They'd been the last of the Lark family, and the last of the island's variety of traits inherited from African fathers and Irish mothers. Penobscot grandmothers and Swedish grandpas almost seemed to have drained out of their clan, terminating nearly in the two wan, peaked cousins, probably siblings, who had colorless hair and colorless eyes, and who, after their parents passed within 2 days of one another in the winter of 1899, out of loneliness and grief, continued their family together, having 9 children, 4 of whom lived, all of whom inherited their parents' pale, colorless features and fragile constitutions, and all of whom were slightly harder of hearing, slightly nearer sighted, slightly more asthmatic, wholly more sensitive to sunlight than their parents, to such an extent that, except for Millie, who attended 3 hours of school each summer weekday, the Lark children were nocturnal and rarely up and about before sunset. Theophilus and Candace managed to stave off starvation for themselves and their children like everyone else. Theo was a competent fisherman and seamster, and fished for cod and flounder, and did the mending for the laundry the McDermott sisters, Iris and Violet, took in from the mainland. The Lark children were largely left to themselves. Winters they clustered together on the floor like a litter. Often enough, 1, 2, or all 3 of the semi-stray island dogs nestled among them, in a nest of rags and hay and old scraps of newspaper and canvas, and the blankets sent by the Relief Society. Summer nights, the children wandered over the island alone, or in pairs, or a trio, or the whole quartet, in the flower sack dresses they wore. Boys and girls alike, glowing under the moon against the dark earth, to appearances wandering aimlessly, spread across the meadows and woods like the ghosts of Apple Island's lost children. When Ehahani came across the children late at night, after he had been clamming with the tide, they wordlessly encircled him, and he, anticipating, gave each of them a little-neck clam, or periwinkle, or whelk. Sometimes he gave them oysters from his wire basket, which he shucked with his scrimshaw rigging knife, careful not to spill the broth. The girls poked the frilled layered meat and slid it around the smooth insides of the carapaces. The boys sipped from the shells like teacups. Theophilus Lark had been a decent fisherman, too, but when the Relief Society began sending food and supplies, a bowl or two here, a wooden spoon and a colander there, the colander disappeared the same day it arrived. The children swiped it so they could scoop sand and seaweed and shells and creatures from tide pools and watch the thin strings of water squirt from the holes. He spent more and more time around the shack, puttering and fussing as if tending house. He fell without a thought to caring for the kitchen utensils, which he rubbed with his rag and lined up on the top of the pear crates they sometimes used for cleaning fish on. He wore a threadbare gingham dress and an old, dirt and oil-stained apron that he carefully folded once over and tied around his waist as solemnly as if it were a Freemason's habit. The dress had been his mother's, the apron his grandfather's. Theophilus's grandfather had been a clerk in a shop on the mainland, in some small town Theophilus could not remember the name of. Theophilus's and Candace's mother had once told them that whenever a female customer entered the shop, their grandfather met the customer right there at the entrance, before she'd even closed the door behind her. "Wearing this very apron I got on now," their mother had said. And he'd ask her, "What lack ye, ma'am?" Every time, just like that, "What lack ye, ma'am?" So Theophilus poked around the shack and brooded over the pile of sleeping children like a mother robin, wearing the dress and shopkeeper's apron. And whenever any islander passed by, he paused at his aimless chores, arose from the chair outside the door and came to the edge of the dirt yard, and wrung his hands in an old red rag he took from the apron's front pocket, nodded at the passer-by and said, "What lack ye, Mr. Diamond? What lack ye, Ehahani?" To the children he asked, "What lack ye, my little salted cods? What lack ye, my little oysters?" Candace Lark never liked housekeeping, and was no good at it anyway. A particular squalor surrounded the Lark's shack when she had been in charge of domestic order. Much of that had been due to the children, who arrived one after another for 8 years, counting the 5 that didn't live. But even considering mothering and scant means, and the necessity of staying home while Theophilus fished, Candace lacked instinct for tending her kids and shack. Candace was relieved at first that she no longer had to make a show of keeping house. Then she grew bored. Theophilus fiddled with the utensils, and the children slept most of the day, and were free to come and go as they liked all night, so she grew irritated by her brother's fussiness with the bowls and spoons and mug. It was as though he were playing shopkeeper. She kept silent because he meant well and she loved him, but watching him hum and wipe out the inside of the mug with his rag and hold it up to the light and look inside it and blow into it as if to get the last of the dust out of it, then rub the inside with the rag again, then hold it up and look inside it again, made her want to snatch the mug and smash it on a rock and shout, "The blasted Christian mug is clean!" So she began to fish. One morning Theophilus sat outside working his rag around the wooden bowl when Candace emerged from the shack wearing his leaky waders, carrying his hand line, hooks, and leaders. "Going fishing," she said. Theophilus nodded. "Looks so," he said. "Want I should know?" Dory said. "Yep. See you sundown." Candace spent the day on the water, learning to keep her balance, standing in the unsteady, narrow dory, and bobbing the line up and down, jigging for what exactly she did not know. She used some leftover chum Theophilus had in a bucket that smelled so horrendous when she took the cover off, she gagged and nearly gave up. But she turned away and took a deep breath, and wiped the tears streaming down her face, and figured the stench was probably good for attracting fish. She baited the gangs of hooks on both lines, and dropped them into the water and began to joggle them up and down. Ahab passed at a distance in his pea pod, and Candace waved, and he waved back. The ocean teemed, lavish and wholesome. Sunlight fell across Candace's face and bare arms, sharp, antiseptic, fortifying. The air tasted full of salt and restorative minerals.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.